See? There are devices that sometimes are implanted in a pig, for example, mm-hmm. but the complete filtration with cells in the animal is not done yet.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right, but you should remember, if you want to implant something, then you have to make sure that it is safe, mm-hmm. and it is more difficult, let's say, more difficult than having a system which is extracorporeal.
Mm, I understand.
So the other project that we have been having is just to create implantable device for diabetes. Just to create a device that you can have pancreatic cells, and if you implant it and you will be close to vascularization, then the body communication, so the cells, so glucose can transport it through, so the cells in the device, oh, the glucose level is very high, I have to produce insulin. So you will have a device that is immunoprotective, but in the meantime can also communicate mm-hmm. with the outside. The challenges are quite large because you have cells encapsulated in the system, and these cells need nutrients, oxygen, so that the device has to be able to allow nutrients, oxygen, glucose to go in and out, and of course insulin and glucagon, because do you know how the pancreas works?
A little bit.
Yeah, so
I have the base, I think.
But this is more than enough. So when you eat and the glucose levels go high, then the cells produce insulin and goes down. If it goes too low, then the cells produce glucagon and goes up. So then you need cells that they have both functions. Mm-hmm. So then we have been using, you know, pancreatic isolates, which is basically combine the alpha and beta cells. Eh? So then in this case, you hope that you will have the both functions. But now most of the devices we have been using are tested for insulin delivery. Mm-hmm. So you just go to a system, maybe you can put it, you know, in vitro in a system, and then you regulate if it goes in and out.
I have a question. When the pancreas doesn't function, there are insulin pump
yes.
that exist and that are...
This is, as we call it, the artificial.
Why do you need to go further? Why do you need to implant pancreatic islets?
You see, that is a good question, in the sense that as time goes by, this, as we call it, insulin pumps, eh, you can have it outside and then you can sense it, become better and better. Mm-hmm. So you can have, let's say, insulin, synthetic insulin, this delivered and quite fast can act, right? So what you, a pancreatic implant will probably be, a more long-term solution, because if you implant it in, then you will not need a continued testes and continued injections, but it is very challenging because you need to have a lot of cells in order to have this function. So if you look at the situation at this stage, I would say the developments in the artificial pancreas with the pumps, which they have glucagon and insulin, they are at least very well. They're going very well, and there's synthetic insulin. So I would say that in the next 4 or 5 years, they will actually dominate. So most of the people with diabetes type 1, young children, they could have a well-regulated system. So now they have, you know, these implants here, and they don't even have to take blood. It's just connected to the device, so they have some kind of implant and it takes continuous blood and toot, and you can see exactly what is your glucose level.
And so you can activate the pump and...
Yes. So those systems, of course, then the communication of the device with the doctor could be wireless, you know, all this data can be stored, right? So then it is much easier. My father has diabetes type 2, so, and he's now 80 years old, so what he actually does is taking blood, he's testing it, he writes down in a book, and he says, okay, how much insulin I should put down, right? So for him is, so I think those elements in time, they will become trivial, especially, right, with the technology. So having a system that it is implantable, then in principle you want something that you can stay there for years, okay. And then you don't have to have the continuous injections.
Because what's interesting is that for the kidney, you said it's easier to be to build an extracorporeal system, and for the pancreas, you are doing an implantable system. So
now, what you see, often the decision of the research is also driven sometimes, you know, with the current circumstances, right? So what you actually see here, for instance, is there was in the last 10 years, especially in the US, was an American program, then a so-called encapsulation systems, basically be able to create implantable devices that they are easy to retrieve, etc. It was very important element. It was very hot topic. And then in this case, then you get requests from all over the world. They say, can we do something about guys? And then, obviously, then the question comes, what type of cells? Where are you going to get them to put in the device? So you have big consortia, and then in the end, you realize that there are good biomaterials to implant. You can tailor the porosity. There are good quality cells. But of course, you have to sow in animal studies and in human studies. And this is what I told you with my colleague, right? And then you have to invest. So actually, these projects are much slower in progress because of that. So now in the artificial systems, of course, the developments continue. So then I would argue, if you are a patient, you want both to continue. And then if let's say the artificial system with the pumps outside, it is the norm for the next 10 years, fantastic. But if there is a solution later, right? Why not? Now, you remember a few years ago there was this so-called decellularization strategies. So what they say, I will take a pig kidney, I will remove the kidney cells, and I will inject back human cells, and then the cells will go exactly where they're supposed to be, and then I will have a living organ. This also did not materialize. You could see that this, you can take out the cells of the animal's origin, but you cannot easily put human cells everywhere because, you know, they have to find a way, there are mass transfer limitations. So then you realize that these strategies also lost momentum. But a few years ago, it was really a very hot topic, and there are a lot of groups who are doing it. The last few years, there is a lot of discussion about organoids. Mm. Right? So, I don't say that it is a lost cause, but it's extremely difficult that you have cells that spontaneously, you know, create a kidney. So now they have these organoids, that if you see an organoid, there is one part which is glomerulus, another part which is proximal tube, there is not enough vascularization, they are quite small. So those type of systems can be used for in vitro testing, can be used for drug testing, can be used for all these type of studies. But if you just want to claim that this can be grown and you could have a large organ, then there are so many elements to be addressed that is extremely difficult. It probably takes 10, 20 years to reach to the point that you want to go to studies with patients, and then so. But nobody says that you should not try it, especially if you are in a research environment. You have this luxury, because then you can say, okay, sounds interesting, or I have an idea. How can I improve vascularization of the organoids? So at least I can contribute in this part. So if this is successful and I can increase the size of organoids, at least we get a more physiological organoids, although they are only very far away from the real one, right? Mm-hmm. So then, often with small steps you can go to the larger goal. So if you are a student, say during my master assignment or during my PhD, I'm going to develop an organ and test it. It is almost impossible, of course.
As you speak of it, what is an organoid for you? How would you define it?
Yeah, well, it's a difficult job because I'm also not very good at it. Is it an assembly of cells? Is it a self-organized tissue that it is? You know, how would you find it?
I find it very challenging because there are many, many definitions and they are not all the same. So,
yes,
I wonder what was yours.
Yes, so we don't work in organoids here, right? So we don't have this, at least in, so for us, I have been involved in discussions for consortia, and then because in the past we have been working in tissue engineering projects, you know, if you want to create a large construct, you want to improve vascularization. If you want to have a device for pancreas to implant it, you want around it good vascularization. So there are strategies to help that. And then it's okay, maybe those strategies could be also used in the case of organoids, right? In order to. So I have been part of those discussions. And then you see there are a lot of important papers coming out, you know, and companies that they are producing those and they sell them. But you see at the moment there are in the elements of in vitro testing for organs on chip systems, etc. So, and of course there are organoids for the brain, there are organoids for the kidney, there is organoids for the pancreas, there is organoids for the liver, and so So Cecile knows much more about it. You know, Cecile was working in the biotech.